Welcome back to the Mayo Clinic Cardiovascular Podcast Series, Interviews with the Experts. I'm your host, Sharon Hayes. I'm a non-invasive cardiologist and vice chair of faculty development and academic advancement for the Department of Cardiovascular Medicine here in Rochester, Minnesota. Today, I'm joined by Dr. Claire Raphael, who is assistant professor of medicine. She is an interventional cardiologist here at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, and her areas of expertise are percutaneous interventions and microvascular disease. Dr. Raphael today will be sharing with us contemporary approaches to diagnosing and treating myocardial infarction without obstructive coronary arteries, or MINOCA. Dr. Raphael will give us some pearls on evolving strategies for diagnosing and properly classifying MINOCA, as well as a conceptual framework for acute and ongoing management. So, Claire, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation.
So, obviously, MINOCA, because of the MI, is a type of heart attack. But how do we how is MINOCA currently defined, and what are some of the causes of MINOCA?
So most commonly when patients have a heart attack, there's usually disease atherosclerosis of the coronary arteries. So you'd see a, you know, maybe 80% stenosis, you might see a plaque rupture, and we'd be focusing on treating the large arteries of the heart. But as you said, the MINOCA is a myocardial infarction where you don't have obstructive coronary artery disease. And we usually define that as less than 50% stenosis in the large arteries of the heart. And the important thing is to say that MINOCA itself is not a diagnosis. It's a description of what we see on angiogram. So 5 or 6% of all myocardial infarctions, you don't see any obstructive disease on the angiogram. And the question then becomes, why have they had a heart attack? So we then look more specifically at the causes. And you can divide them up broadly into problems within the coronary artery, problems outside of the coronary artery, but within the heart. Things that look like a myocardial infarction but aren't a myocardial infarction, and occasionally misdiagnoses. So starting with things that can happen in the coronary artery, in the same way we commonly get plaque rupture of the 70 or 80% stenosis, we can also get a plaque rupture of a non-obstructive stenosis. So it would be a plaque that's only 20 or 30% stenosed, but even these can rupture. And we'll usually get clues for that from the angiogram. The angiogram might look a bit hazy or a bit disrupted. And if we're not sure, we can do intracoronary imaging, so things like IVUS or OCT, to look in a bit more detail at that plaque. Sometimes it will be a non-obstructive plaque rupture, but we won't see it directly on the angiogram. And then we start looking at rarer causes. So the arteries look completely normal, nothing that looks like a plaque rupture, nothing that even looks like obstructive coronary artery disease, but a patient that comes in with a classical myocardial infarction. And there you start looking at the rarer causes, things like coronary spasm or coronary embolism, spontaneous coronary artery dissection. Sometimes that can be missed on an angiogram, and things like microvascular disease. And like I said, also misdiagnoses, we can sometimes just miss something that's very distal, especially if you're doing an angiogram in the middle of the night. Sometimes when we look again, we do see something more subtle. The next thing to look at is problems outside of the coronary arteries. So the most common thing is supply-demand mismatch. So the arteries themselves look okay, but the heart isn't able to produce enough supply to meet the demand on the body. So if the patient's critically ill or they've had extreme blood loss, they're tachycardic, you know, they've got an SVT with a heart rate of 200, often they'll get chest pain and get a troponin rise. And those are considered to be an MI due to supply-demand mismatch. And then the final thing to look at is things that look like a heart attack, but actually when you do all the investigations, there isn't a heart attack. So these are the MI mimics, and that's things like Takotsubo syndrome or myocarditis, or some of the cardiomyopathies will present in this way. So hypertrophic and dilated cardiomyopathy often have supply-demand mismatch. And it's only really when you get the angiogram and the rest of the imaging that you then realize that actually this isn't a problem within the coronaries, this is another cause of MI.
That is a true broad category. And obviously, each of those entities are going to be treated quite a bit differently. And really important, as we're increasingly realizing, as we sit with patients who've had a MINOCA in the office 6 weeks later, what diagnostic testing is really important? I mean, one thing you mentioned is looking hard again at the angiogram, like, are there clues? So that would be, it seems like an obvious one. But what can you do in the cath lab or during that hospitalization that might help me 6 weeks later when I'm seeing the patient? We still maybe don't know. So tell us what other diagnostic testing to sort out the diagnosis.
So usually if someone's suspected of a myocardial infarction, a lot of the time they'll get an angiogram. And that will usually be the first time I meet the patient. So looking within the coronary artery, if we're not sure what's happening, we can do intracoronary imaging. And that's really great for picking up what's going on within the arteries themselves. So is there a plaque rupture, spontaneous coronary artery dissection? Dr. Hayes, you're obviously the expert with that. On angiogram, sometimes that looks an obvious diagnosis on the angiogram. Sometimes it's a bit less clear. Sometimes you're thinking, is this atheroma? Is this SCAD? I'm not really sure. And in that case, intracoronary imaging, particularly with OCT, is really helpful. And OCT is optical computerized tomography. So using light waves to look within the coronary artery and see what's going on. So it's great for plaque rupture. It's great for SCAD. If it looks like there's a lot of clot within the artery, but is this embolism? Is this a plaque rupture that's happened in situ? Doing imaging will really definitively answer that question. Occasionally, if there is a lot of clot sat around, we can do thrombectomy and look at the clot itself. So visually, you know, is this red clot? Is this white? Has it been around a little bit longer? Is it more organized? So as well as visual inspection, occasionally we do send those specimens to pathology, which help us decide where they've come from.
That's what you do in the cath lab. You know, as you said, sometimes you leave the cath lab and you know it's a MINOCA because there's no obstruction. Tell us some of the other things you might do during or shortly around the peri-diagnosis that can help us.
So one of the most useful diagnostic tests is cardiovascular magnetic resonance. And you talked about seeing the patient in clinic 6 weeks later. The real best time to do the CMR is within that same hospitalization. Yeah. So it's a lot more sensitive. It will give us a lot more information. And that can help you with the MI mimic. So in an early phase, you'll see myocardial inflammation. If this is myocarditis, you've got the late gadolinium, which will help us with patterns. And we tend to lump it into two main categories. So with the late gadolinium, that helps us decide if this is an ischemic pattern or a non-ischemic pattern. So the ischemic pattern basically means you've had some disruption to the blood supply within the coronary arteries. And that will make you think of an atherosclerotic event or spontaneous coronary artery dissection, or embolism or spasm. And if you've got a non-ischemic pattern, so you might have mid-wall fibrosis, then you might be thinking about a cardiomyopathy, but you'd also see classic patterns that might make you think about a Takotsubo's or a myocarditis. And really early is best with the CMR. That gives you the greatest yield.
Yeah, and I would agree. I just think that the role of cardiac MRI has really expanded and is still really underutilized. I think that one of the things, and you may wish to talk about it, is we recently said, if we've got a MINOCA, let's make sure all of us are on board and we're getting that early cardiac MRI here at Mayo in Rochester, because of, I think increasingly, we're doing more angiograms. We're seeing more of these patients. And I think we certainly saw it during COVID, where there was a lot of myocarditis and a lot of myocardial infarction. And getting it right was really important. Are you seeing a rise in the use of CMR both here at Mayo and outside?
I think so. I think over the last 10, 15 years, I mean, looking at when I was doing my training, when the patients came in, you do the angiogram and you say your coronary arteries look fine, must be something else. And that would be the end of the diagnostic testing. And really now patients are asking, why? Why have I had a heart attack? You know, I'm a 30-year-old man. I'm otherwise in really good shape. You know, is this something that I need to be really aggressive with my statin and my lifestyle? Or, you know, maybe this was a myocarditis, especially as you say, with COVID, we've seen a huge amount. So, I mean, it's really vital to have a proper diagnosis rather than MINOCA, which helps the patient, helps us decide how to manage them medically, and just hugely different ways you manage compared to, you know, if you have a patient with coronary embolism, you're going to be thinking about oral anticoagulation. If you've got a patient with spontaneous coronary artery dissection, you'd be thinking about referral, screening for fibromuscular dysplasia. With spasm, we tend to treat with calcium channel blockers. So it's a real massive shift in spectrum that, you know, takes us away from the traditional atherosclerosis where we're looking at the statin and the aspirin and modifying risk factors. So definitely the earlier the better with CMR, and really just looking for that definitive diagnosis for the cause of MINOCA.
Well, you sort of touched on it, but once you have made the diagnosis of whatever of these, what treatments are you, you know, obviously, and additional diagnostic testing, like you talked about embolus, why did somebody have a blood clot to their coronary artery? Very rare. So talk a little bit more about the care of the patient post-diagnosis.
So like we were saying, the management completely depends on the cause. So in your non-obstructive plaque rupture, so say you've suspected that on the angiogram, you've done intracoronary imaging, you've confirmed this is coronary atheroma, perhaps there was a plaque rupture, you treat that like any other MI. So they haven't had a stent, but they're still at risk of future recurrent events. So mainstay is aspirin, getting them on high-intensity lipid-lowering therapy, aiming for an LDL less than 70 or less than 55, depending on the risk factor profile, and then thinking about beta blockers, ACE inhibitors, and so on. So they're the ones that we're familiar with. The spontaneous coronary artery dissection, they're a really funny entity. Each of us individually as a cardiology interventionalist don't see these very often. So really the best thing is referring them to a specialist clinic like yours, Sharon, where patients are seen by someone with a huge amount of experience in SCAD and can just help them through that journey of what is this, is it going to happen again, and how to manage. Looking at coronary embolism, it's again a different entity. So we're looking at the source of the embolism. So within the hospitalization, you might think about transesophageal echo, see if they've got any clot in their left atrial appendage. You might do extended monitoring for atrial fibrillation like you do with a cryptogenic stroke. Some of the patients that come through, they've got a mechanical valve, and often they've been under on their anticoagulation, and that's what's caused the embolism. In young patients with no obvious cause and you've just suddenly had an embolism, you might think about thrombophilia testing. And then the other thing is just having a bit of a lower threshold for when to consider oral anticoagulation. So it's not a well-studied phenomena, but around 10% of people that have had a coronary embolism will have another one. So the question is, do you start them on oral anticoagulation? So there's no real guidelines for that. Certainly if they've had a recurrent event, we would think about anticoagulating them with oral anticoagulation, or if they've had recurrent DVTs or other procoagulant events, or if there's multiple risk factors as a predisposition. So that's really a discussion to usefully have with hematology, with vascular medicine, if that's a unit here, and then, you know, having a shared decision making with the patient to decide how to manage them. The other thing we've sort of touched upon, but I'd like to talk about a little bit more, is thinking about functional testing. So if you have someone who's come in with a typical myocardial infarction pattern, relatively normal coronaries, but an ischemic pattern of late gadolinium enhancement on their MRI, then it might be appropriate to test them for microvascular disease or coronary spasm. And the way we do functional testing, so it's another angiogram, we tend to go femoral just because that way we don't need to give anything in the radial sheath to dilate up the arteries. And then we do functional testing, so we give additional medications during the angiogram to see how patients respond. So we give adenosine and we give acetylcholine. So it's something we do really routinely here at Mayo. The procedure takes about an hour. It's pretty low risk. We tend to say around 1 in 200 risk of causing problems. And we measure the coronary flow reserve. So that's looking at the flow within the arteries at rest and with hyperemia with adenosine to see whether they've got normal microcirculation. And then we also try and induce spasm of the epicardial arteries. So you give acetylcholine. In someone who's got completely normal arteries, you actually vasodilate with acetylcholine. But in someone with a predisposition to spasm, then their arteries will constrict down when you give the medication. And that's really useful for clinching the diagnosis where it isn't clear. With spasm, it's not always necessary to do the functional testing. If they've got a classic history and they've got ST elevation that goes away, and every time they get pain, it's relieved by nitro and the coronary arteries themselves look normal, there's enough from the history to say this is spasm and you'll treat as spasm. But often the picture isn't as clear cut. And sometimes that additional functional testing can be really helpful. So in terms of who to test, I tend to consider invasive functional testing in patients with an unexplained myocardial infarction who've got an ischemic pattern of late gadolinium, and particularly if they've got ongoing chest pain. So there's something that makes you think maybe they are still having problems with spasm that needs to be diagnosed. Patients where probably testing isn't needed, patients with established atherosclerosis, this is probably a non-obstructive plaque rupture. They've got moderate atherosclerosis all over their coronary arteries, and it's a single event and they don't have ongoing pain. And then patients where you've got a clear alternative diagnosis, so you know it's embolism, you know it's myocarditis, they don't need to undergo another angiogram with, although it's low risk, it's still not a no-risk procedure. So that's another thing to consider. And we tend to consider that usually 6 to 8 weeks after the MI, just give whatever acute process a bit of time to settle down before we do this functional testing.
Yeah, that was going to be my question, is do you ever do that really early? And I what I've observed is we want to wait and let things settle down a bit. I guess I as a referring cardiologist, you have found this type of testing so helpful for some of my patients with kind of unexplained ongoing symptoms, or say we've said, oh, we think this is plaque rupture, that's most likely, but now they've got horrible statin intolerance, for instance. And so, and now I'm rethinking that sort of default diagnosis. So I think sometimes we are faced with doing empiric therapy, either for spasm or for coronary disease, and our empiric therapy does not result in the expected benefit, or they have side effects from that empiric therapy. I'm not saying empiric therapy is inappropriate, because I think if you're pretty sure, like you, the description you had of spasm, but it's when that spasm patient can't tolerate calcium channel blockers or nitrates and they're still having chest pain, I think sometimes that's where we really need to nail the diagnosis. And that's where doing that can be really helpful.
And we do get surprises. We've had a few patients come through who have, you know, had two or three stents, and actually the problem all along has been spasm. And there's bystander coronary disease that's been treated, but they say, I don't feel any better. I'm still getting this chest pain. It's still classic chest pain. And you can get some fantastic angiograms where almost everything except the stent is almost completely occluded. And then this stent sitting there like, you know, the snake that swallowed the elephant. And they're quite striking diagnoses. But like you said, especially when someone's got ongoing pain, it's really helpful to just revisit and re-question the diagnoses.
Well, as you alluded to earlier in this conversation, this is a relatively new concept. Certainly when I trained, this patient population was told, like, go on and live your life. Like, this was a fluke. Nothing to do, right? And then we started seeing them coming back, and we have that. So what's on the horizon? What do you think? Because it's a relatively young field in terms of exploration. What's next? What should we expect? Are there any clinical trials or therapeutics or diagnostics that we might see on the horizon?
So I think the main thing is just using more what diagnostics that we have. We've definitely seen a massive upsurge in CMR. I think that message is getting there. That's really useful for diagnosis. But functional testing, I think less than 6% of people that come through the cath lab with ongoing chest pain get a functional test. And there's still only a few referral centers that still do this testing. So I think just greater awareness and making sure we appropriately select and then refer patients that have got ongoing pain or recurrent MIs with no clear cause, and just dig a little bit deeper to try and get that diagnosis. I think that's really important for patient management. In terms of trials, the most exciting thing on the horizon at the moment is a device called the coronary sinus reducer. And that's been something that's been trialed in angina with no PCI targets with patients with microvascular disease. And we've seen anecdotally some patients with spasm that have responded to it. So, I mean, no focused trials on spasm or MINOCA at the moment, but this is really a big player in the field at the moment that I think we'll see a lot more of in this area.
Well, thank you so much, Claire, for this exquisite discussion about MINOCA, because we're just seeing it more. And I think it puzzles a lot of us. So thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for the invitation.
Well, this wraps up this week's episode of Interviews with the Experts. I'd like to thank Dr. Raphael for joining me today and discussing this really important topic. We look forward to you joining us again next week for another interview with the expert. Be well.